Now, here's a tale that's straight out of a movie. Now, three men who were stranded on a remote Micronesian island for over a week have been rescued. The three set off on Easter Sunday for Micronesia, but they encountered problems with their boat and got stranded on the Western Pacific island. Their niece reported them missing, launching a coordinated rescue effort involving the U.S. Coast Guard and Navy. They were found thanks to a help sign, which they spelled out on the beach using palm leaves. There's another twist to the story, though. Turns out one of the rescuers is a relative of one of the castaways. Now, how's that for an unexpected family reunion? So NASA is now preparing to return men to the moon after half a century, and soon they could be joined by four-legged robots who are undergoing training to walk on the lunar surface. Take a look.
This is Spirit, a robot that is being trained to walk on the moon. Scientists are testing it in the rugged terrain of Oregon's Mount Hood in preparation for future missions in space. The research is part of the LASSEE project, which stands for Legged Autonomous Surface Science in Analog Environments. Cognitive scientist Christina Wilson.
Moving forward to missions that are going to occur on our moon, we're going to have humans and robots really for the first time on planetary missions working side by side. And so what the LASSEE project is doing is really looking forward to that time and considering how should humans and robots collaborate for exploration of planets, particularly where should they go to collect data.
The idea is to teach Spirit how to cope with difficult and changing terrains in the same way humans do, such as walking from hard or rocky surfaces to soft ground like snow or sand.
With every step that the dog robot takes, it's able to sense kind of mechanical resistance with its leg, kind of similar to the way that when we walk on uneven surfaces as humans. And what's very cool is that scientists are interested in that data because it tells us things about how planetary surface formed and how it moves and how it might move in the future.
The LASSEE team is comprised of experts from NASA, Texas A&M University, Georgia Institute of Technology, Oregon State University, Temple University, and the University of Pennsylvania. The group has a two-year, $2 million grant to help NASA put teams of robots working together on the moon.
In Peru, cases and deaths from the dengue epidemic there have more than tripled so far this year. According to government data, the number of deaths from dengue rose to 117 in April, compared to just 33 in the same period last year. Suspected cases have also swelled to 135,000. The government has declared a health emergency, unlocking economic measures to strengthen the strategy against the epidemic. The FBI, concerned about the possibility of an organized attack in the U.S. following the March 22 deadly concert hall attack in Russia. The attack near Moscow killed at least 144 people, the deadliest in Russia in 20 years. The Islamic State militant group claimed the responsibility for the attack. Now on Thursday, FBI Director Christopher Wray sought to persuade the House lawmakers to boost funding for the Bureau amid security concerns.
This is a time when we need your support the most. We need all the tools, all the people, and all the resources required to tackle these threats and to keep Americans safe. Increasingly concerning is the potential for a coordinated attack here in the homeland, akin to the ISIS-K attack we saw at the Russia concert hall just a couple weeks ago. We also need funding to counter the threat from the People's Republic of China, a government sparing no expense in its quest to hack, lie, cheat, and steal its way to the top as a global superpower and to undermine our democracy and our economic success.
Russian missiles and drones destroy a large electricity plant in Kyiv, or near Kyiv, and hit power facilities in several regions of Ukraine. The Russian Defense Ministry says it hit fuel and energy facilities in what it describes as a massive retaliatory strike. Russian President Vladimir Putin says Moscow was obliged to launch the strikes in response to Ukrainian attacks in recent weeks on energy targets in Russia. He adds Russia refrained from carrying out such attacks in winter out of humanitarian considerations. Kyiv's appeal for urgent air defense supplies from the West have grown increasingly desperate since Russia renewed its long-range aerial assaults on the Ukrainian energy system last month. Hamas leader Ismail Haniyeh denies his sons were killed in an Israeli airstrike Wednesday where fighters in the group's armed wing. When asked whether their deaths would impact ceasefire talks, Haniyeh says the interests of the Palestinian people are placed ahead of everything. He adds Hamas is still seeking a deal, but Israel has been evading a response to their demands. The killing of Haniyeh's sons was coordinated by Israel's military and intelligence service without consulting top commanders or political leaders. That action is seen to complicate efforts to free hostages still held in Gaza. Israel bracing for possible retaliation for the killing of a senior general and six other Iranian officers in an airstrike in Damascus on April 1st. Israel's military spokesman says civilians were not being told to make any special preparations, but adds Israel is highly prepared for a range of scenarios. Most Israeli troops have been pulled out of Gaza in preparation for an assault on the southern city of Rafah, where more than 1 million Palestinians are sheltering. But fighting continues in various areas of the enclave. The U.S. remains concerned about the risks of escalation in the Middle East following threats made by Iran towards Israel. The U.S. State Department says Secretary Antony Blinken has asked counterparts in Turkey, China, and Saudi Arabia to use their influence to stop Iran from attacking Israel.
We continue to be concerned about the risk of escalation in the Middle East, something we have been working to mitigate and contain since the attacks of October 7th, and specifically about the threats made in recent days by Iran against the state of Israel and the Israeli people. We have been engaged in a series of contacts, not just at his level, but at other levels too, to talk to foreign counterparts to send this very clear message to Iran that they should not escalate this conflict.
Russia also calling on all countries in the Middle East to show restraint and prevent the region from slipping into chaos. American football star and actor O.J. Simpson, who was acquitted in 1995 of murdering his former wife, has died at the age of 76 after a battle with cancer. Simpson was one of the best and most popular athletes of the late 60s and 70s. He parlayed his football stardom into a career as a sportscaster, advertising pitchman, and Hollywood actor. But things took a turn after Nicole Brown Simpson and her friend from Ron Goldman were found fatally stabbed outside her Los Angeles home in June of 1994. Considered the prime suspect, Simpson was cleared by a Los Angeles jury in what U.S. media call a trial of the century. But he was found responsible for her death in a civil lawsuit and later imprisoned for armed robbery and kidnapping.
And it's kind of tragic and sad, and you know, for such a talented guy, and he was a lovely guy when he was at SC and you know, previous to that. So whatever happened with the drugs and the relationship and you know, the trial and everything else, it's just kind of a sad, tragic end to his life, which could have been so much more.
Not gonna miss him.
How do you think the wife?
I don't have any personal animus to him, but I just think I don't have any hatred toward him, but I think he murdered his wife and he got away with it.